My name is Mariam Kamara. I'm an architect from Niger, and I run a firm called Atelier Masomi, which is based in the capital of Niamey. The work that we do really engages with the local context. It is a work that is about, you know, unearthing the memory of a place. It is about looking at the context in everything that it has in terms of its challenges, in terms of its opportunities as well, and try to figure out how to bring to the fore an expression of architecture that could really be true to a given place.
Hello, my name is Aïcha Macky. I'm director and producer of Tabu Production. I'm not hooker, and I'm trainer of trainers about cinema, and my focusing area is documentary and civic engagement. I'm sociologist by trainer, but I turn to go to cinema because half of population is illiterate, and for me it's a choice to build a bridge between population and the audience through camera, through image, which for me is an international language.
So I met Aïcha about when? 3 years ago? 2 years ago we met?
3 years.
3 years ago. And because I was very much curious and interested about the local creative scene, and I noticed that everybody kind of in their own sort of world knew each other. So as filmmakers, you know, there's a few of you, you all know each other. Architects all know each other, and others as well. But there was no cross-pollination and kind of like no cross-engagement between creatives. And I was really interested in meeting more creatives that are not architects. And so I think the first time we met was when I set up this dinner.
Yeah.
And there were so many of us, and there was you, there was another Jalud. Filmmaker, Jalud, there was a poet, Altes. There was
Maman,
our biggest, you know, star out of
Niger. Alfadi, so I think.
Alfadi, fashion designer. You know, it was just really beautiful, beautiful evening, you know. And I think for me, the hope was that we could have more of these things so that we can exchange more and maybe kind of think about collaborations and new projects could come out of our interaction. And I think you specifically kind of grabbed my heart, you know, in a way.
Thank you.
Yeah, because I remember after that evening, I asked you to send me the link for your film, the very first one, which I'm sure you'll tell us about a bit later. And I watched the film and I was so overwhelmed. And I remember just thinking, what a powerful storyteller you are. You just had this way of telling the story that made it so intimate and that made the viewer really feel like they were on this journey with the people you were interviewing and whose stories you were telling. And so I was just really looking for an opportunity to work with you, because I was just thinking that, you know, in my work, that's also what I do. I tell stories, but through buildings. And I tell our stories or the stories of the people, you know, if let's say if I'm not working in Niger, it would be the stories of the people of that particular place, right? In however way it brings up. But yeah, but how was it for you?
Yeah, I think the first time we meet together about the dinner with mm-hmm. some creators from Niger, it was a big opportunity for me to discover some creator. And when I know that you are an architect, I say that it's wonderful, because the cinema is a kind of art which can gather all kind of arts, mm-hmm. because I can make a portrait of architects,
yes.
I can make a portrait of traditional house, mm-hmm. and I think that was amazing for me. And when we think about the collaboration to narrate the story of yes. Guntiena,
mm-hmm.
about the center which you want to create in Niamey, mm-hmm. and I see that it's a way for me to narrate this story about mm-hmm. colonization and how this place can take another image and mm-hmm. to be a bridge between the young people and to be connected with their culture.
No, I think we have to, because I remember when I was thinking about the fact that this story of Niamey, I didn't know about it until I started working on my thesis for architecture and then discovered all of this, you know, the fact that Niamey was actually made by the French from scratch. It was just a fishing village. The fact that they used that valley in the middle that we all know about, but that we never think about, that they actually used it as a barrier between two worlds to create their own world and then the world of the indigenous population. I just didn't know how to tell that story. You know, it was a story that I had been talking about, but I didn't know how to show. And I remember when you came in and we talked about it for like 4 hours.
Yeah.
We were talking about this forever. And you had this immediate idea of narrating it like a fairy tale. And I thought that was so beautiful because what better way? I mean, not a fairy tale, like the traditional storytelling, you know, sessions that we all grew up with, when we would have an aunt or, you know, a grandfather or a grandmother who would sit the children, you know, around, you know, in the village or whatever city we lived in. And after dinner, you would all gather around, you know, and hear this beautiful story, right? I thought it was just such a powerful, you know, concept, but also so evocative, and that really spoke to this place specifically. Someone else, even though I think the film was for an exhibition that was in South Africa, it was for Cape Town. But at the end of the day, I think what is really important for me is that both you and I, the way that we tell the stories really speaks to the people, not necessarily to an audience that is outside. Yeah. And there's something really unusual there, because I think often the temptation is to tell the story in the way that people overseas would understand, or, you know, the art world would understand. Yeah. But I think what I really enjoy when we talk together or when we collaborate, we're really trying to figure out how can we make people locally understand the story.
Yeah. Nelson Mandela said that if you want people to hear you, we can speak in the language you want, but if you want people to understand you, you have to use the local language.
Exactly.
This is why you use the Hausa, the most spoken language in Nigeria. For me, the cinema is the best way to show, to narrate some people which don't really have the voice, and particularly women, because we have a lot of lovely story too.
Yes.
And this is why I choose this kind of channel to narrate my people and to narrate myself too, because I have a lot of stories. This is why in the Fruitless Tree I narrate my own story and my own story and my mom's story. To talk about motherhood, because as a woman, you know that if you get married, we have to make babies. And my mom passed away when he was giving birth, and when I get married, I have to give birth. It was amazing for me to get married, but I have some fears about perhaps giving birth is for me passed away because of my mother's story. And this is why I say that I can use this channel to give voice from some women and to narrate just my country. I have particularly a test about taboos, because there is a lot of stories that sometimes people can say that no, you don't have to make it because it's taboos. And for me, all thematics have to be narrated, because we have just to choose the approach to narrate it.
The same thing in a way, because we were supposed to make two projects, which was, you know, making a library and making a mosque. But what I thought was an opportunity was to actually just make one project, right? Because at the end of the day, then we start asking questions about, you know, what is religion really? Like, what is Islam, you know, to its core and the essence of it? You know, what are the things that are important to the religion? And then all of a sudden you start realizing that actually, you know, this is a perfect opportunity to have conversations that enlighten rather than, you know, kind of maintain people in a certain messaging that is coming from elsewhere that radicalizes them. But that has nothing to do with the religion, actually. That doesn't have any truth to it. And so all of a sudden, you know, we made this project where you had a mosque that had been turned into a library, which people were very angry about, you know, in the beginning. But then we were able to have these deep conversations about the importance of knowledge in Islam and how Islam actually says that one of the responsibilities that you have as a good Muslim is to go and seek knowledge all the way to China if you must. That is very important. And so all of a sudden then, when we did more research, we started figuring out that actually in the beginning of Islam, mosques were also research centers. They were also libraries. They were also schools. They were basically centers. They were not just one religious edifice. So it was really a good opportunity for us to also have this discussion on a theological level with a population, but then also make a project that helps to fight that. In the sense that, you know, I always talk about how you can be in the library, and then because thankfully we pray 5 times a day, so at some point when you're in the library, you have to walk to the mosque and then you walk back. And psychologically, this walking back and forth between the two spaces helps you really get rid of this idea that knowledge, especially secular knowledge, somehow is the opposite of religious practice, or that it's a problem with religious practice. So that instead, the young people who live in that village can have this experience and grow up with the notion that the two actually go together. And I think at the end of the day, you know, for both of us, that's really what our work ultimately, I think we want it to be, right? You know, for me, whether I'm talking about, you know, thinking about a project like the cultural center that we're doing in Niamey, which was the first opportunity for our collaboration, you know, it's just all these, the storytelling. But the storytelling itself is a tool, right? You know, at the end of the day. So I think that's really incredibly powerful. And I think in a way, that's why I wanted to meet as many creatives as possible, because it was about exploring how do we tell these stories in multiple different ways to multiple different people, but constantly. You know, you said something in the beginning about, you know, the importance to tell our own stories, because for too long we have been narrated by other people. And to this day, we're still narrated by other people. We're being defined by other people. And what's really exciting right now is that we get to define ourselves.
Coming to Niamey, it really changed my life, because here it's like closed for me, because you can't go and come like in Zander. And I think having this kind of education, which is like we create some community, is it's not the same coming to Niamey, the capital. This is why all the time I have some particularity in my, even in my movies. I have to use some architectural thing, like if I'm shooting, I can go to shoot, for example, the rocks in Dandar, and I shoot it like to show it like a big kind of like traditional village, and it's the most powerful sequence in the film. This I like really, because it narrates me my childhood, because in these rocks, like a slide and playground in where we are, all the child are going for this place, and we are going some sululu.
Yeah, the slides.
Yeah, sululu, don't to slide with my brothers, sisters,
on the rocks.
And on the rocks, and it's really important for me to have and to keep this kind of habitude in somewhere in my mind, that you come from this space and you have to maintain it, because it's your in my all the time in my movie, because some colleagues are talking about, Aïcha, why do you want, why do not go to make some series, making it in French or in English? I say that, oh my goodness, I have my local language.
Right.
And in my movie, I have to improve where I come from, and I have to make the advertise about my story, about my identity. If I'm going to make some movies through the language of some people like Western, perhaps I can make it for Western, but not for my country. And me, my challenge, I'm challenging myself to make it first for my population, and after for others.
Yeah.
And this is why the local language is so important for me, to make my movies to be understood by my people first, and after we can make it a translation in the subtitle in English, in Japanese, and Chinese, and all over language of the world.
Well, because at the end of the day, other people do it, right? Like if someone is from Denmark, they make the movie in Danish, they're not going to feel that, oh, you know, we should make this in French, you know. Obviously that would be absurd.
Yeah.
They will make it in their language and you will subtitle it, you know, and that's that. So it's the, why should it be different for us? And why should we uphold someone else's, you know, identity in the place of ours?
Yeah.
You know, I completely agree with you. And I think this is, again, you know, these are all the parallels that we have between our work, right? And the funny thing is, you know, I think in a way, because both of us didn't grow up in Niamey, now living in Niamey and working in Niamey, the fact that we didn't grow up here is making it that we see these things more clearly. You know, I think it would have been much more challenging to be who we are had we grown up here, because it's so outward looking, because it's looking to the West so much. But instead, it made us, you know, the kind of people who not only are we aware of a deeper identity, you know, of the country, because we grew up in small towns, you know, of the country, but then when we come to Niamey, we have a point of comparison. So now all of a sudden, we also appreciate more, you know, these cultures that we grew up in, which we took for granted when we lived there. And then we come to Niamey and then we realize, like, wait, people don't live like that here. Why don't they? And then the question is, why don't they live like that here, right? And for me, that's the question that I always ask through architecture as well. Because what I look at, you know, same thing, right? It's really these memories, these childhood memories. You know, for me, it was growing up in the desert, you know, near Agadez. And it was about, you know, having seen the town of Agadez and how these, you know, how the houses were, how the whole kind of old town was structured, you know, going to visit my grandmother, you know, in the village, you know, for a month at a time, you know, or something like that, and having a very rural kind of way of life, and starting to wonder, well, why are we running so far away from that? And you see that when you come to the capital. Then, in a way, I think the good thing that Niamey gives us is that it gives us something to fight for. Yeah. Because now we're realizing that, oh, this is actually a problem. Because we know better. We know, you know, the kind of how important, but also how valuable our real culture is. And then we can make these comparisons. And we can start to think about the environment here, or the people here in your case, in terms of what is it that we want to say? What is it that, for me, the question that I always ask was, you know, how can we continue living in this way? These joys that we had, you know, as children, how can we hold on to that? But how can we hold on to that in a way that is not necessarily about going back to the model of our childhood, but how can we take that model and move it forward and make, you know, a 21st century version of it, instead of going to, in the same way that you're talking about, going to kind of apply or imitate someone else's reality or someone else's modernity, right?
Absolutely.
So in a way, it's incredibly important that we grew up in small towns, but it's also incredibly important that we live in Niamey now, because it allows us to ask these questions.
It's not the same space, it's not the same people, and the habitat is not the same. And I suffer really two, three years, and I'm all the time searching my place about how can I dress without saying that he come from village, and how can I speak without the fear to say that he is speaking like coming from village. And all the time I have to, I don't know, it was really a challenge for me to have my place in the capital. And I'm saying that, why can I have to make some speaking like speaking
with a French,
French
accent?
French, like with a French accent, like.
Yeah, as though you're from France.
If I want to say Mariam, I have to say Mariam. You know that? It's like, really, it was a big challenge for me. I said that I'm really happy to be what I am and to be what I want to be.
Yes.
Not just to be what someone wants me to be.
Exactly.
And yeah.
And for me, that's really the challenge, right? You know, it's just kind of, how do we, at the end of the day, you know, for me, architecture is the most powerful conduit of surf representation, right? At the end of the day, you know, 100 years go by, 500 years go by, or even civilizations that we talk about today, we talk about them through their architecture.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, that's the thing that remains. So one of my fears is that the way we're going, what's going to happen is that if, imagine 500 years from now, or like let's say 5,000 years from now, someone excavates our cities. I think if this person is an anthropologist, the way we're going, they will actually think that it was the same people that lived here, that lived in France, that lived, you know, in the US, that lived, because we have all homogenized. So we are erasing ourselves actually from history, in a sense. You know, when you look back in history, you see the pyramids, you see, you know, the Nubian pyramids also, not just the Egyptian ones. You know, you see the amazing architecture of India, you see the amazing architecture of South America, you know, the Incas, the Mayas, you know, and all that. What would we be able to show? Nothing. We'll be able to show pale copies of someone else. That is very disturbing, you know. But to your point, you know, why can't we just be ourselves? Why is it that somehow we need to, you know, project someone else's reality?
But you know, even going to some festivals, when you come, it's some kind of cleavage about the world cinema,
right,
and the African cinema.
And
for me, speaking like African cinema is like Africa is like a small village. No, we are a continent, and in this continent there is a lot of people, a lot of habitude, a lot of identities, and for me, we have to cherish our place in this this most powerful place, like to just speak about cinema, not a cleavage about African cinema, because sometimes it's a kind of stereotype. It's like we are filming a bush and you are filming a village, a habitude of village, and no, we are making a cinema and we are making some contemporary thematics.
Absolutely. And I think that that's what, you know, I would love if you can talk a bit more actually about your film Zendaya, because so we both have a love affair with Zendaya. Like, I, you know, it's the city of my dreams. We went there together, and it was a really beautiful moment, because, you know, we can see how the city is changing and completely turning its back on its history, but also a lot, how a lot of the history is still there. You know, you were talking about your family home, you know, which is very much a traditional home, you know, from how it was, you know, like 300 years ago, you know, or something like that, right? That you know, your family still lives in, which is amazing and beautiful and has to be, you know, preserved. But then, you know, the power of the film that you made about Zendaya, you know, for me was incredibly, this jewel that we need to preserve, that we need to help survive, architecturally speaking. And through that film, I saw a different dimension, again, even architecturally or even in terms of urban design, you know, about this city, because I found out about this entire neighborhood that was created to put away, you know, people who had leprosy. And then now, as you're saying, you know, these are their children, you know, so what is it that a city also does, you know, when you create these things, when you actually, you know, ghettoize large portions of the population, which actually is an incredibly contemporary, you know, problem. It's a problem that exists all over the world. It's a problem that you can talk about in the US, that you can talk about, you know, in India, that you can talk about, you know, anywhere. It's this problematic of parking people that you find undesirable into a certain section of town. But then you realize a generation later or two generations later, the same thing happens, it, no matter the reason. You know, so for example, in the Western world, often we make that a race thing. You know, it's people get parked away because of their race, and then all of a sudden, you know, their behavior is attached to their race. So if there's violence, you know, in a black neighborhood, it's because black people are violent. But then you see in this particular example, what I find powerful is that the race is taken out of the question, right? Because this is literally the situation where you have a town that created a sector and a section to put people who were sick, and then their children became very violent, and they became, you know, disenfranchised, and they became marginalized in the society. And actually the exact same thing happen to them, that happens all over the world whenever people are put aside. And to me, that was incredible, you know, to watch and to learn from, you know, through the movie.
You know, that coming from Zandar, you know, it's a CD with a lot of story, particularly about colonization. And we have some kind of architectural story, even about the city gates. It's called in Hausa Garu. Donc les Garu de Birni. Birni is the authentic name of the neighborhood. And told about my dream to make some collaboration to talk about this story through architect and through telling story through camera. And I think coming from this country, coming from this neighborhood of Zander, we have to make it because it's about our story. And the story was narrated to make this dream really, and to make it powerful. And because I know that if you go together, it can do something powerful, and it can be really amazing. To go to this amazing adventure, to narrate this story and to make something that can be like a contemporary story, like about some kind of the world city, like as you know. This is my dream.
No, it's such a beautiful project. I cannot wait for us to start working on it. And I think we're going to start sooner rather than later, honestly, because, you know, for me, the idea of, you know, looking at a city like a town like Zander, what is history? You know, you were saying at the beginning how, you know, Zander was the first capital of Niamey because, you know, when the French came, they settled there and the population was not very friendly, you know, to them, obviously, you know, and kind of kicked them out and they had to like run back to Niamey. But also these city gates and those city walls, you know, are a huge reason why they were able to defend themselves against the French and were able to kind of like, in a way, almost lock them out of the city. So the idea of doing a project that would rebuild that, you know, rebuild the gates and maybe even rebuild some of the walls where possible, because also the city has expanded past those boundaries, would be incredible, right? You know, in terms of heritage, Zander already being a place, you know, where we have architecture that is 300, 400 years old, you know, sometimes, you know, that is lived in, that is alive today, and then be able to rebuild these things, you know, in a way, you know, would be a project like, you know, how Rome, you know, was rebuilt, right? You know, today we think about Rome as this ancient, you know, antiquity, you know, city, or like classical city or something like that, but all of that was gone. They rebuilt it. So this would be an excellent, you know, precedent also. You know, I think for the continent, as one of those additional ways in which we heal ourselves from what happened to us, from, you know, the ills of colonization, because part of colonization also meant that a lot of our architecture was destroyed throughout the continent, right? Some of it survived, like in Zander or in Agadez, but some of it didn't, you know? And so, you know, these kinds of projects are incredibly important. This kind of rebuilding is incredibly important to cement also in our own minds. You know, when you bring back something that was erased, you would give it life again, but then in the minds of people, now all of a sudden there's this trace of our history. Because the problem that we have is that I think even locally we're starting to believe that narrative that we didn't have a history. Yeah. It's almost as though there was no history until colonization. It was just which
exist.
Yeah. Before it's like we didn't exist, right? You know, and there's the term that is used in Europe, that was used back then in Europe to refer to Africa, was the dark continent. As though it was just kind of this place. It wasn't just about the color of our skin. It was also about this notion that it's this black hole of nothingness, you know, that there's nothing there. And so this project, I just cannot wait for us to start working on, because it's just the power of it, you know, is indescribable. The beauty of it also, you know, these gates are so beautiful and amazing, you know, and being able to recreate that and reconstruct that, I think would be, and for me, it would actually be the honor of a career, right? And then putting that to film, you know, and making kind of this collaboration, you know, with the architecture going on and then a film going on in parallel at the same time, that will be about telling the story, not so much the story of the rebuilding, but the story actually of the city that accompanies the rebuilding. I think this is going to be our best collaboration yet.
Yeah, I think we have to
About teetoast to that
about the project.
Exactly. Exactly. No, I'm looking forward to it. Thank you, Aïcha.
Thank you. You're welcome. Thank you.
It was amazing. Wonderful. Thank you.